Just give me the light. Just give me the light. Just give me the light.
Shine the pal. Yo, yo.
Just give me the light and pass the joe. What's another buckle of more? Yeah, let me know my sight and I got to know which one is gonna catch my flow.
The attraction to reggae music, because it's real. It's life music.
Reggae music is the heartbeat of the world.
Reggae music is probably the most spiritual form of music.
If you listen to traditional reggae, it pulses at the same rate as the human heart, and it will actually give you a heart massage on the right sound system.
Instantaneously, you feel something.
It's just like rap music. It has that same power and that same force and the same drive.
Reggae has always been a music with a message.
The people of the world know that this music is the healer. It is the medicine, it is the tonic for the soul.
Reggae dancehall is now back in the charts, having largely been away since the mid-90s. With much of the hype coming from New York, MTV Bass went to the Big Apple to speak to the major labels, journalists, radio DJs, producers and artists to find out why acts like Sean Paul and Wayne Wonder are just the start of things to come. America's love affair with reggae isn't new. It can be traced back over 40 years to Jamaican immigrants who landed in New York, bringing with them their infectious music.
Calypso originated as really slaves rebelling against their masters, and this was just get loose and to heck with them, we're gonna party. From that now, in the early 60s, late 50s, priorities changed for people of color, for Africans in the diaspora, priorities changed. Yes, the physical bonds of slavery had been broken, but there were still issues and, you know, inequalities. And coming right forward to the 70s, to the words of Bob Marley, mental bondage, you know, still existed, and people needed messages that were emancipating. And that's really the basis of reggae. It's the only music that had or has a soulful, a spiritual purpose at the onset. That is what reggae was created, to give a voice to the voiceless.
Get up.
If you go anywhere in the world and you say that you're from Jamaica and I've been around the world, people will say to you, oh, Bob Marley, right away. They may ask you for weed right after that.
He was the one that really made it internationally known. I mean, you do have Burning Spear, Peter Tosh, John Holt, and Dennis Brown, and all those other acts that made impact on a scene still pulse third world. But on a major level, Bob Marley was doing stadiums in Germany. He was doing stadiums in France, in Italy. Some places in the world, people think Bob Marley is reggae music. They think there's nothing else to reggae music but Bob Marley.
This music is a bit spiritual, and people are drawn to that. The people of the world know that this music is the healer. It is the medicine. It is the tonic for the soul.
Like any form of music, I think reggae's popularity kind of stems from the music itself. I mean, there is an infectiousness about reggae music that I don't think you get in many other forms of, you know, in many other genres.
Reggae has always been a music with a message, and I think that has shown through all throughout the years as the music has evolved from just straight reggae into, you know, more dancehall.
Sim Simma, who got the keys to my bima? Who am I? The girls them sugar? How can I make love to a fella in a rush?
Not only did reggae attract fans from all corners of the globe, it also captured the imagination of many rock and pop artists, such as Eric Clapton, The Police, and UB40, who could not resist the draw of reggae.
All forms of life, everybody use reggae. Take like Sting, for example, you know what I'm saying? Sting with The Police, they was influenced by reggae, you know what I mean? Eric Clapton, I Shot the Sheriff. Stevie Wonder, Wyclef Jean, the Fugees, No Woman, No Cry. We stay reggae, you know what I'm saying? UB40. So it's definitely, it's been around from the beginning, you know?
Say, I remember when we used to say,
where at,
son? Oh, in a project yard in Brooklyn.
Oh, yeah, right, when I left KG.
And little Georgie would make the fire line. Stolen cars pass through the night.
For me, it started off with sound system. But I was real young, because you know I'm an old man now. And it was like a Stone Love tape. And I heard a reggae voice, a Jamaican selector. And I was amazed by the way his twang sounded. You know, he was like, Enzana the Don Zons, we move. You know, and I was like, yo, that's cool. What language is that? And it was like, no, it's English, you know? And so started getting into the sound tape. King Tubby, the Wicked bass lines, you know, the whole group, Sly and Robbie. And then just started playing like basement parties. And so with the Fugees, like, we just naturally grew up with reggae.
Most of the guys that doing the hip-hop stuff, they're using the sounds from the reggae, mostly Sly Dunbar. They're using a lot of his drum tracks to do hip-hop.
Bass, the final frontier.
The first Grammy that was handed out on the televised Grammy ceremony went to No Doubt for a single produced by the two most prolific gentlemen in the world besides Quincy Jones. No one has more of a discography than Sly Dunbar and Robbie Shakespeare. If you go in a website and try and print out their discography, you better come back tomorrow. That was the single that was nominated. Of course, then on the nomination sheet, it's not mentioned featuring Bounty Killer, but we love him and we know it. And reggae is kind of used to those little disses still, you know. And dancehall is used to them too. But that doesn't make it any less a fact that you live for Bounty's voice on Hey Baby. You're living for the moment his voice comes up.
Check it out, check it out. It's Bounty Killer, no doubt. Jump on the stage, yes, they going crazy. Have to win myself in one of them gorgeous ladies. There is no need to be hacking shady. Come on, baby, hey, baby. Jump on the stage, yes, we going crazy. Have to win myself in one of them gorgeous ladies. There is no need to be hacking shady. Come on, baby, hey, baby.
Reggae's compulsive nature captured not only the dancehall, but also came under the eye of the big record labels who were keen to tap into the potential profits. In the post-Bob Marley era, artists took huge amounts of inspiration from reggae, and while some groups paid back, some were accused of using its worldwide popularity for their own purposes without fully acknowledging the originators.
Exploitation of this music by other genres is negative and it's positive. It's negative when the genres do not pay respect and homage to where from to whence they got the stuff they're sampling and also the influence they received it from, you know. It is positive in the sense that it opened doors and eyes to reggae dancer.
I think any form of music, period. I mean, if it's good, everybody gonna pick it up and run with it. You know, like rock and roll, for example, you know what I'm saying? We was like a Tutti Frutti on a Rudy, went Bamboo, next thing you know, everybody runs with rock and roll. I think with reggae, it's the same way. I think sometimes you see certain people do reggae songs and they blow up, and then somebody from the island, a local, would do the same song and the song wouldn't go nowhere. And you'd be like, well, what's going on here?
The music business is all about exploitation. You know, you take something that people, have created in a natural environment and you try to, you know, pump it up and sell it. I mean, there's times that rock and roll bands have done straight reggae songs and no one would ever suspect it. The Eagles' Hotel California is one of my favorite examples.